Hi everyone, I'm really excited to interview Sushant Verma. He's a design entrepreneur, architect, computational designer, and educator, currently leading RedLab Studio. I recently attended his workshop on Computational Next, which was quite insightful. So without much ado, I'll directly jump into the interview. So hi Sushant, thanks a lot for your time for this interview.
Okay, thank you Mayur, and it's a pleasure to speak to you about this. Thank you for having me on your show, I would say.
Yeah. So what inspired you to be an architect?
So I actually belong to a family of architects, I would say. But that's not something that inspired me, to be honest. Quite an irony. So I have always been interested in any kind of creative fields. I've always been interested in technology. Genetically, I was, I think, blessed with some mathematical genes because my mother used to be a mathematics teacher and also an artist, and she used to paint and she used to be very creative in various things. And so I think that's where I inculcated that. And my father is an architect, but that was one reason why I was actually always running away from architecture, because we could always see all our life, see him working so hard and passionately about every single thing that he was doing. And we were really worried that, you know, this is a very demanding profession. So I really was kind of running away from it. But as luck, you know, kind of pushed me towards this, and there are no regrets whatsoever, that I somehow got pushed into giving the examination, clearing that. And after that, I got my calling that, you know, once I visited the campus of my college where I was possibly going to join, since I'd already cleared the entrance exam, I loved the feel, I loved the vibe of the place. This was Sushant School of Art and Architecture. And, you know, like you entered and you see like as if you're in a museum, because the walls were painted, there were murals. So I was really caught up in the creative vibe of, you know, of architecture. And that's when I realized, okay, it's not probably that boring, you know, as it seems to be, you know, looking at the drawings and things that I'd seen. And I think that's something that kind of pulled me towards architecture, I would say. That's how it all started.
What is your design philosophy?
My design philosophy, it's a very weird thing that I always say, is that I don't have a design philosophy, and that is my design philosophy, because I don't believe that architects or designers should have very, very strong philosophies of design and principles of design, at least very early in your professional journey, I would say, because I think that's a problem which a lot of people get into, that you develop your style or philosophies way too early than experiencing the profession. See, architecture, as we all know, we always say that practicing architecture, you know, like, and you're a practicing architect. And it all says in the name of it, because you have to practice the profession and the art of creation and technicalities and all sorts of things attached to that. And you develop it as a lifestyle. And that's what architecture is. So the moment you have a design philosophy, I think everything kind of goes very restrictive, and you can't adapt to it. So coming to the word adapt, so adaptation is actually my design philosophy, that you need to keep adapting to new. You need to keep changing, keep evolving. And I just stick to that, you know. And of course, now I stick to, apart from adaptation, I stick to, like, we have to be innovative in everything that we do. So I think that's pretty much what has become our, you know, design philosophy, so to say. And every project is different. Every task that you do is unique in itself. And the idea is to innovate.
Let's see. And you have worked at Zaha Hadid Architects. So can you share your experience?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was a life-changing experience for me. I think I was very fortunate to be in the right place at the right time, that, you know, after doing my master's at DA, when I was hunting for a job, pretty much left, right, center, because it was a very bad time, that, you know, that phase, because we only had like 4 months to look for a job, and then you had to find a job which is sponsoring you, which means they have to prove that you are better than any other citizen that time. So I mean, visa rules keep changing, and they were quite tricky that time. So I think I was happy that I got the opportunity to be interviewed at the office, and I got interviewed by Patrick Schumacher, who's now the principal of ZHA. And I think that was a life-changing moment for me, because he noticed the right things in my portfolio, my profile, the works. And the moment I joined the office, I think it was such an exciting place because you see like 300 people around you who are unique in their own ways, yet all of us are working towards a single core mission to make the most impactful and the most creative and the most path-breaking architecture that you could work on. So there was a very interesting learning environment in the studio. There were people teaching each other various skills through working on various things. There was a very collaborative environment. And yeah, I think I really got exposed to a lot of interesting things. I met some fantastic people. And I think it was a very interesting point personally as well for me to get a realization that whatever I knew or whatever I was doing until then is actually making sense. You know, whatever skill set that I had developed in the last few years before that was actually making a lot of sense because people of the same caliber were there around you, you know, who were heading the projects of such large magnitude, I would say. So I think it was a very motivating aspect that you realize, okay, you are also there, you know, you've arrived at a place where you are also, people know you, people want to understand what you do. So I think that was, a path-breaking moment in my life when I realized that, okay, you know, I know something and that's why I'm there, you know. And at the same time, yeah, you learned a lot of responsibilities, handling those projects. It was a fun place to work and very intense though, very, very intense. There were like crazy working hours at times where, and it's not that somebody would like hold you to kind of work, you know, around the clock towards something, but the energy, the creativity, everything was so charged up that you are bound to, you know, be in that environment and become like that, you know, so hardworking and like working all the time. So I think it was a very path-breaking, you know, moment for me. And I think anything that has happened after that as well has played a really big role in that defining what we do now as well, because we look into projects and innovation in that sense. And I was always drawn with, you know, fluidity in architecture and, you know, the curvilinearity in architecture. And that's what my journey in the previous, you know, early days have been as well as a design student. I was always drawn towards things which are more complex or fluidic. So, you know, being at ZHA, it definitely gave me a learning platform as well while contributing to the projects that, you know, this is how fluidity is made in design. So now let's say if I design a building or a project and I would draw a curve, it would kind of come close to the kind of works that we were doing that time, I would say. And that's one thing which you can only learn with experience and practice. You know, nobody can teach you how to design. I mean, I think Zaha had quoted that once that you can't teach anybody to design. You can just create that kind of an exposure or, you know, inspire people basically. So that's what ZHA did for me as well. It inspired me to do the kind of things that we're doing now, I would say.
Mm-hmm. How does a typical day in your life look like?
Typical day in my life look like, oh, it's quite crazy actually. Nobody would want to be in that position, I would say. It's quite busy. It's super busy actually. It's very intense. And it's been like this since, I can't even remember, since many years now. Because I think as a student of architecture, and you would probably relate to that as well, it teaches you to work all the time, you know, to be so driven about your work and what you're doing next. And that has kind of, you know, become a part of me, I would say. And it really become a part of my life now. And I'm working quite hard, I would say, in terms of the quantity of time I'm putting in. And I'm not ashamed of saying that, but yeah, I'm putting in 25 hours a day. And that's the kind of intensity is. And the moment I say 25, anybody would ideally say like, what the hell is 25? You're 24 hours in a day. So that's exactly what's happening in my life right now, that I'm seeking for that extra 1 hour as well. To make a difference, to bring about a change. So that's how it's been busy. If you ask me like to define like how the typical day looks like, I would, since we're in a lockdown right now, by the way, that has also given me a lot of flexibility to work in a different way. Now we are having a team of, you know, almost like 12, 13 people in different time zones, and managing all of them, you know, through different time zones. And then we are teaching in different time zones as well. So there is no schedule. I mean, we're trying to manage things. I need to learn how to manage things better. But I sleep for 6 hours. rest of the 18 hours, I would say, pretty much are centered around work, you know, which is blurred with the personal life as well, because we are all home right now. So the professional and personal life is kind of blurred, but at the same time, the day is quite busy. So I'm jumping on from projects to pitches to finding out the right, you know, leads in the competitions which we want to work on, motivating my team members to be able to work with the same kind of vision. And then education is a big part of my life right now. So RatLab Education has really grown multifold in the last few years, where we're doing so many programs, conferences, again, something that you were a part of recently as well. So that is, you know, keeping me quite busy. So the whole day, if I like break it into parts, there's like, you know, in terms of work, I would say 50% of it goes into, you know, handling the projects. About 30 to 40% goes into the design education part. And the rest 10, 15% goes into innovating in things what we haven't done before and trying to seed that into profession and academia both. That how do we, what else can we do? What new we can do? How can we inspire more people? How can we bring our story forward as well? So yeah, that's how pretty much a day looks like. So I'm sure nobody wants to live this kind of a life. Yeah, it's crazy.
I see. And if you can name one book that had made a biggest impact on in your life, what would that be and why?
Okay, I'll tell you very honestly, it's kind of funny. So my business partner, Pradeep, who I started RatLab with, he gifted me this book when we were in LA. It was on my birthday, and like he wrote on the cover of the book, "To the Crazy One I Know." And he always kind of related me to this person. So it was Steve Jobs' book, the biography. And that's one book which has inspired me a lot. It has changed my perception towards how I look at things. And to be honest, I have not read the complete book, but still the book has changed, you know, me in various ways. I have read it in parts. I keep going back to the book, reading the same things again and again, few statements, few things said here and there. And that has really inspired me, because I really believe in like what Steve Jobs did as an innovator, I would say. So I think that that's one book. But coming to architecture, I would say there have been quite a few books which have really like changed the way I would perceive things. But the first book that really impacted me a lot and still does is The Atlas of Novel Tectonics. It's a book by Jesse Reiser and Umemoto. So Reiser plus Umemoto, they had this small little book, Atlas of Novel Tectonics. And it was my guide and mentor, Abhishek Bej, who actually introduced me to that book while I was doing my dissertation when I was a student. And my whole dissertation and thesis was actually centered around the principles learned from that book of tectonics. And funny enough, we had just launched a workshop on digital futures world, which is called Scalable Tectonics, Speculative Futures. There as well, I'm actually revisiting the principles from that book, which I read like 12 years back. So it has had a really big impact. It's a very simple, very interesting book. And yeah, that's one book architecturally, which has inspired me and changed the ways I think.
Yeah. And can you share challenges faced in your career and how did you resolve it?
We face it every day, man. I mean, challenges keep coming every day. So there are different kinds of challenges. There are like work challenges, there are emotional challenges, there are, you know, how to deal with stress and how to deal with a lot of work, how to deal with when you are not able to, you know, be more creative or innovative in some aspects, you kind of fight yourself out and stuff. So there are challenges of various kinds that come across in various ways. You know, how do we face it? I mean, to be honest, we kind of started to love the challenges, because that's where it drives innovation. You know, you have to see the opportunities in any adversity that kind of happens. And I really believe that, you know, you have to have a sense of adversity quotient, you know, in your mind, apart from your intelligence quotient and emotional quotient. You have to have an adversity quotient, that any challenge that comes onto you, how do you deal with that? So we've had quite a few, actually. Like if I have to start naming, it can be like, you know, a project getting stalled suddenly, you know, like, or payments getting stopped and your whole business model kind of changes or has to adapt to something new, or the pandemic happens, which has happened now, and your whole way of working, what you've developed in the last 5-6 years, needs to change quickly and immediately. You know, like those are the kind of challenges, how to restructure your team, how to inspire people at times when they are losing their focus, to how, you know, since we are dealing with education, you know, we are dealing with a lot of fragile minds as well. We're dealing with students a lot of times. So how to respond to them in a certain way, how to help the students in certain ways. Those are also challenges. Like if a student comes to you and says, you know, I'm not able to understand certain things, that's a challenge for you to be able to teach that and teach that in the right way. Now I'm actually working on, you know, a big issue of mental health as well for design students, that how do we help people who are facing these kind of challenges so they don't end up getting into depression of any kind, because it's a very challenging profession, I would say. I mean, it throws you challenges of different kinds every now and then. And that's something that you can't predict or learn, but all you can train yourself or your mind is how to deal with challenges and convert them into opportunities. It's very cliche to say that. It's very easy to say that, but it's very difficult to develop that skill set to face those challenges. So we do face these kind of challenges. I think projects getting stopped at abrupt places, in terms of at abrupt stages, when we put in the hard work, everything is ready, things getting stalled, or somebody just pulling out at the wrong moment. You know, we're dealing with a lot of collaborators, somebody not being that innovative, or somebody not finding the innovation factor that you're trying to bring on the table, and suddenly like pulling back to a conventional option, let's say. Those are the biggest challenges that we face, and we still face that, and we will continue to face them, and we will have to learn to deal with those challenges. We have overcome that as well. I think a lot of mental preparation, I would say, and not losing faith in the profession, in the country, in the kind of people that we are dealing with, and getting a fresh start always. I think that's how we've learned to deal with those challenges.
Yeah, so like adapting yourself according to the challenge and making them into opportunity and have the right mindset.
Absolutely. Like for example, right now I can give you a very recent example, you know, which happened with the pandemic. You know, like I know everybody is saying that we are adapting to the new normal and all of that, but to be honest, it's a very big impact that we are having, you know. For example, I mean, the economy is kind of going in a bad shape. I mean, so how do you deal with that? Because that's kind of trickling down to everyone. How do you cope up with managing the finances, the business? The growth needs to be sustainable. You know, once you start growing at a certain pace, you have to maintain that. Even if the growth factor dips down, it becomes very difficult to adapt to that. And it gets very difficult to accept that. So suddenly when you realize that, you know, 2020 has to be the year of survival rather than the year of innovation, which you wanted to make it happen at the start of the year, the whole strategy needs to change, you know, so that you kind of get back into it in a new shape. So how we are adapting right now to new systems in place, new administration in place, new kind of team which can be positioned in different time zones, new talent which can be brought onto the table, you know. So I think we are kind of adapting fine. Although it's challenging to work remotely for all the things, because there are a few things which require, you know, physical presence as well. Now we are like busy restarting all the sites and all the projects and, you know, getting all those work started as well. It is definitely challenging, but we are adapting to the new normal, I would say.
Mm-hmm. And any mentor who made a significant contribution in your career?
There have been quite a few, actually. I mean, there have been mentors in my life. And this is something very recent that I started to believe, that you need to have mentors in your life, you know, in some way or the other. And it's, in our profession, it's very difficult to find one, to be honest, because, you know, architecture is a profession where very, you know, the moment you start to succeed, you can be a competition. You can be in the same space and competing for the same kind of projects. And that has happened in the history of architecture in various ways as well. So how do you deal with that? That becomes kind of difficult. You know, when your students start to, you know, be at the same place where you're kind of competing for the same things as well. How do you deal with it as a mentor? How do you deal with your mentors being you know, ahead of you in certain ways, and you start to be in the same zone or same circle or same discussion points? It's a very different, you know, dynamics that are involved into this. And to be honest, nobody talks much about it. Having a mentor is very important. I would say the biggest mentor that I have had, like the most impactful, has actually been my father, I would say, who is an architect. And what I've learned from him is how hard he works, and he's always worked throughout his life. So I would say that's an unsaid thing. I've never actually told him that you are my mentor. You know, the moment I say that, we'll have a very awkward kind of relation, you know. And that's something I used to say that to my mother as well, who's not there in the world anymore. But yeah, she passed away last year. And I used to tell her that, yeah, I mean, I've learned so many things from you. But I wish I could tell her that you were actually my mentor as well, because all the creative skills and everything that I learned in terms of mathematics is something that I learned from her. So I would say my biggest mentors are my parents, because that they are the ones who kind of shaped me in many ways. But in terms of professional mentors, I would say, because my father hasn't been my professional mentor, you know, I actually haven't discussed architecture with my father, and he's an architect and he's done like the house I live in. I love this house, and that was his dream, and like he's built it, and I'm happy to be here. But at the same time, I've never taken professional advice from him, because we don't mix it. We don't mix the personal and professional life somehow. Like, that's something that I follow. And now my wife is also an architect, and we don't try not to discuss much of work. But professionally, I would say, as I mentioned previously, like Abhishek Bij was a big mentor for me, and has been continuously, you know, kind of guiding me at various steps as well. And yeah, he was my dissertation guide, my thesis guide. And then I had Manit Rastogi, you know, from Morphogenesis, the founder of Morphogenesis, and he was my mentor at one point of time, who's played a big impact. And I'm not like really in touch with him much, but whenever there is a big crisis, which had happened like a few years back, he was there to help me out on that kind of a situation. So it's very important to have mentors. I think those are two people I would say I'm kind of grateful to as well as my mentors. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now we will move to our next section, which is about your professional work. So can you give us an overview about your research and professional work?
Yeah, so RatLab is actually involved in various kind of scales and typologies of work, I would say. So right from facades, we're doing a lot of facade projects, we're doing some office spaces, we're doing like installations, art installations in residential projects. We're doing a couple of residences as well now, something that I never wanted to do, but now I'm finding a lot of my creativity coming out in those kind of projects. And then we are working on a lot of collaborations on some urban scale as well, roof structures, building skins. So those are kind of projects we're working on primarily. A lot of office spaces now as well, co-working spaces, collaborative spaces. And now hopefully we're developing some new algorithms for, you know, implementing artificial intelligence and machine learning as well to come up with like some innovative solutions in programmatic aspects. And we are developing a lot of tools, like we've developed some tools for auditoriums, for stadiums. So that's the kind of broad spectrum of works that we're doing. And at Crux is only one thing common, which is design technology and innovation. That's what we're trying to bring on the table as a collaborator on various projects. So our research is actually driven very much into developing tools and workflows and techniques and technologies for making projects more efficient, cost-effective, fabrication friendly, and all sorts of things. At the same time, the architectural and design projects are of various nature. Like, we've also done a lot of restaurants and hospitality projects, and that's pretty much what we are involved in right now. Architecture projects take a lot of time to take shape though. So a lot of facade projects are, you know, on the site, some are in development, but the research projects, those are the ones which kind of brought out very, very much sooner. Actually, we developed like tools of various kinds, so we keep on releasing them and sharing with various architects and collaborators. So that's the kind of works that we are doing at the studio. And so yeah, I think every project is different in its own ways. And yeah, overall, that's what we are doing right now.
Mm-hmm. And can you walk us through one of your project? What was your design approach, lessons learned, and your final output?
Sure. I mean, like, there are quite a few which have been quite interesting. I'll tell you about two of them, actually, which I can just coming to my mind suddenly, where we kind of did something very interesting. One has actually been put on hold though, but I love that project. I hope it kind of restarts from some point. It's a religious building. It's an institutional topology. It's a temple project in India, in South India, which we worked on with the Chennai-based architects and who got us on board as parametric consultants. And we really worked on the project in a manner where we had to develop some sacred geometries and forms using computation, which we thought. So again, you would not typically see a project of that kind of typology where you start to apply computational design. But we really dug into the mathematics of sacred form and geometry. And there were some vastu and numerology constraints on that project where the number 11 was very important for the clients. So we actually used the number 11 and developed this algorithms, or a series of algorithms rather, where we could do a form finding and development where everything in the building was about the number 11, of how it transcends from the number 11 to a space. So there was an 11-sided polyhedron called a hendecagon that becomes into a three-dimensional form with 11-sided polygon. So it becomes like an origami kind of a structure where there are 11 parts coming in together. The flooring was again dependent on a mathematical aspect of the 11 points converging to a single point where the idol statue is going to be placed. And then, of course, we brought in like computational techniques of environmental studies and structural design and all sorts of things. The pattern was again based on number 11. So that was a very interesting project for us. And I hope that kind of restarts and kind of takes shape and we are able to take that forward, unless the developer takes the ideas that we had developed and builds in themselves. I hope it kind of still ends up into a good shape. And the other project that I can talk about, which was quite innovative in the way we did that, was one of the experience center projects we did for a stone factory. This was like about 3 years back, 3-4 years back, I think. I think 3 years back we finished this project, where we were given a very interesting brief that do something with the stone, because they were dealing with stone of all kinds, and they were dealing with CNC milling of stone. That was their primary operation. And they were doing some very interesting and innovative work, actually. And they came up with this thing that it has to be cost effective, which is something, a brief that you would find in typically most of the Indian projects. They said it has to be cost effective and it has to exhibit or demonstrate a usage of stone which hasn't been done before in our country. And how do you fuse technology and conventional methods of building? So we used white marble and created a CNC pattern where we had this triangulated kind of faceted surface, or a shell, I would say, an internal shell, where the walls kind of converge onto the ceiling, which kind of comes onto the floor in a certain manner. So it's more like a faceted shell, which is subdivided algorithmically. And many of these triangles, about 20% of these, were made with marble, white marble, which we typically use as flooring pattern. And it was used as a lighting element in the overall space to create an ambient diffuse lighting, basically. So we could actually use marble for a lighting element for a very interesting cladding system that we developed using an algorithmic approach. And that's what we found very, very interesting as an output, because we formed a new methodology of making and constructing it on site without any efficient measuring tools, actually. So there were no measuring of angles, but formation of point cloud system that we developed for that project. And I think that was a very, it's a small scale project, more of an interior space, but very innovative, I would say, in terms of how it kind of manifested into as the output. So those are the two projects I can tell you are at two different scales, which are very interesting. Yeah,
like both of these projects sounds quite interesting. And based on my research, I found that you have worked extensively on material intelligence. Can you give us an overview and talk about your key findings?
Right. So this is something that me and Pradeep were very keen on doing at the beginning, because, we started RatLab in 2012 when we were doing our, master's thesis. And we never knew it's going to kind of grow into what it is right now. But to be honest, that time we were doing our thesis on adaptive skins, which was developing a facade system. We were pretty much challenging a conventional dynamic facade or adaptive architecture, that how does architecture move, or how can a building move or adapt to its external changes? So that's when we came up with the project Adaptive Skins. I mean, not really came up with the project, but eventually kind of developed it through extensive research, which we did at MTech Studio and at the AA, where we started to question that any kind of movable architecture is actually using energy and then utilizing that energy to move to be able to adapt and save energy. So it's kind of a cyclic system where it's not really efficient, you know. So that's why we realized there hasn't been any innovation happening. And then we stumbled upon a few projects. I remember Akim Menges had done and led this project at ICT Stuttgart, where they were, I think it was called Hygroscope, which was looking into material intelligence, where a material can kind of fold using the relative humidity in the air. And that really inspired us. And then we started to look into various materials which can change shape. And we actually found this material called nitinol, which is a nickel and titanium alloy. And it was not really readily available. We actually found it in an online toy store, which was for a hobby store or a science store, I would say, who was selling that as springs and threads. So we actually ordered a lot of these from somewhere in UK. And the moment we got them, we tested it out. The string actually changes shape and shrinks when you pass electricity current through it or you heat it. And we have this, you know, video as well on YouTube about Adaptive Skins project, where we are using a heat gun to heat a spring and it kind of changes shape suddenly. It shrinks down. So with that, we kind of, you know, infer that it is creating a lot of force. How can we use this force to create motion into a building? And that's exactly what triggered the project of Adaptive Skins, where we developed this highly complex tensegrity structure system where these springs are thoughtfully positioned and configured in various ways. We had to do a lot of iterations and testing. So when we heat that, it starts to move and adapt. And the idea was that how can we put that at a large scale in a building where it is positioned as per the climatic understanding of the building, and the building can change shape automatically using the heat from the sun, so without using any electricity or trigger, and start to change shape and start to cut the excessive heat coming in or light coming in and self-adapt to itself. That's the future we saw. And that's the future we still see. And hopefully that kind of comes into reality at some point. Or even if we don't develop that forward, somebody develops that and takes that forward from our research, which we developed using somebody else's research. You know, that's how research develops and innovation happens in reality. So the project Adaptive Skins was a very, very interesting project for us, which brought us into the understanding that we need to focus on materiality, and every material has a sense of intelligence. And also the project that I mentioned about using marble for a backlighting material, you know, it is all the intelligence of the material or the potentials of the materials that actually shaped up the project, not the aesthetics, not the kind of form that we came up with. That's a byproduct, I would say, but mostly the material intelligence. But to be honest, most of the projects do not allow or give us that leverage or experimental ground to do that, but we try to do that in various ways, because I think every research develops into some other project and takes shape into some other project. So hopefully every material research that we are able to do transcends into something else in some other project in the future as well.
Mm-hmm. And can you share your story, like how you started Red Lab, how you met your co-founder, and how did you decide this is the right time to start?
Yeah. Okay, cool. So I would say, So me and Pradeep were working, we met at the AA in London, and I remember meeting him. So I'm sharing like a very personal insight to it, that when we met at the AA, like we never, I don't know if we formed groups together, we never worked together, we never interacted much. And I think a few terms in MTech went by quite harsh, I would say, if I may put it in a very simple way. It was quite a difficult and tough time for us to adapt to, because we were not used to that kind of a pace of education, and like I was facing a lot of health issues. So there were quite a few things happening, you know, at our respective ends. And both of us were somehow the kind of left out individuals, you know, in the batch, I would say. And when the time came when we had to form groups for our thesis, you know, I think I remember we kind of looked at each other and realized that nobody's going to form a group with us. You know, like, why don't we kind of work together? And that's where it all started for us, to be honest. And while doing our thesis, we developed that kind of an interest and understood that how we are kind of similar in so many ways and different and unique in our own ways, that we both have this passion towards bringing about a change and making innovation happen. And we are both interested in technology in some sense. And our project was quite interesting because, you know, even after M.Tech program, it kind of, we floated it out into various publications and conference proceedings, and it got shortlisted. We got awarded and the opportunity to move to Los Angeles because of that project, which we actually did eventually. But before that, I think it was one of those days during our thesis when we realized that the industry lacks research and the industry lacks the application of technology in design. And we were actually talking about not just architecture, but any creative field and discipline. And that's when we realized, okay, we need to form, let's form a group, let's form an organization, let's form a blog, you know, all those kind of ideas came in. And we thought that, you know, we need to form this, you know, more like a lab kind of a thing, because we really believe in experimentation, and a laboratory culture is something that we want to cultivate into this small group that we are forming between two of us. And then we thought we'll start to invite other people with similar passions to kind of join the team and gang. And it actually happened like that. And we started to do some competitions on the site while finishing our thesis, and then even after that as well. And that's when RatLab organically grew in 2012. And that's how it all started for us. And I remember discussing all of these things very interestingly recently now in January, because in December, we finished 5 years of RatLab's Indian journey, which has its own story in itself. You know, we actually made it into like a small documentary, which we haven't made public as of now. We thought we'll release that to our followers, but the pandemic happened and we kind of put that on hold for now. But me and Pradeep now met, when we met recently in London, now he's teaching in Bartlett. He was teaching at the AA. He's had his own journey of being in various places as well, right? From China to Germany to England, and then now back to England as well. And he's teaching in Bartlett as well. And we, when we met recently, we were actually discussing about all of these aspects, how we met at this place and how we used to give our juries, how scared we used to be. And somehow we are kind of working with the same people now who were pretty much the jurors or our tutors in some way or the other. And we are very happy and we feel very blessed, to be honest, that we have made some kind of an impact and some kind of, you know, change that we have tried to bring into profession and academia to be able to represent, you know, ourselves in that medium. So that's something that, you know, that's how it all happened. You know, that's the journey of RatLab, I would say. And of course, there have been various things and changes that have happened in between. We've been joined by some amazing people, and like the team has like grown multifolds. The team size and bandwidth keeps changing all the time, as in how the situation kind of changes. And I think it's quite interesting. Like one thing that stays always is that we are still seeking innovation. Like we're still trying to bring about a change in everything that we try to do. And I think that's what drives us in different ways. And now me and Pradeep are handling some very different aspects of the organization, to be honest, because he's completely into education and research now. And his contribution at large comes in, you know, some very, very complex projects and tool developments that we keep doing. And my forte is about handling the projects in India and like handling the organization in India and putting people together. So I think it's very interesting that we keep evolving, and every year has been like a different thing altogether.
Mm-hmm. And what's your dream list of people you want to collaborate with?
I always thought I would want to work with Zahadid Architects, and that in a way happened in a different sense. I was kind of working for ZHA, but I'm quite happy that, you know, I do get to have some interactions with Patrick even now. So in January recently, like I met him and for the book that I'm working on, and I kind of had this very interesting dialogue with him, which is now being featured into the book, which is going to be launched soon. And then I'm a big fan of Frank Gehry for some reason. Like, I don't like his work. It's a very weird thing that I say this. I mean, I'm in no position to actually judge his work because I really respect him. But I love Frank Gehry for the fact that the kind of change that he brought into the industry by bringing in technologies, and he changed the industry for good. And I think that is something I really admire. I've had the privilege, I would say, to see him in person as well. Not an interaction, but my interaction with Frank Gehry was that he entered into ZHA's studio once when I was working there. And I said hi, and he said hi to me. So that's the kind of fanboy moment that I've had. And I've been into Frank Gehry's office when I was in Los Angeles because I was interviewed to be a part of the studio. And I pretty much got through the job, and then the company got sold. It was Gehry Technology, and the company got sold to Trimble, and their policies changed, and I had to wait for a while. And at that time, I moved back to India, and I set up the studio in Delhi, and I went back, basically, I would say. So, yeah, I mean, people I would like to collaborate with, I hope I get to collaborate with the big architects. I really love their works and the kind of things we do. I see a lot of similarities in the kind of visions that we have. Of course, they are quite big, and as the name, not just by the name, but in the kind of works that they do as well. So I think we are yet to, you know, reach that kind of a scale of work, especially in India, because again, as I said, architecture takes time. And although we have made some kind of an impact in a short span of time, developing architecture and making those buildings speak for themselves, that takes time, you know. So we are still at a very nascent stage, I would say. So I hope that happens someday and we get to collaborate with these fantastic people. Apart from that, we are collaborating with some very interesting people in India as well. Some of the very, very known names in the field of architecture and in different capacities. You know, so for me, collaboration is not only about collaborating on a project or when you're kind of collaborating as two architects, but even if you're like on board as a consultant and, you know, bringing about our expertise in certain ways, it's a collaboration in certain sense. So, but internationally, I would say, you know, big architects, and I mean, there are quite a few. I'm probably forgetting a lot of names right now, but they are all on my top feed on my Instagram and Facebook, which keep kind of popping up. And we are having dialogues with quite a few people for a lot of interesting cross-country collaborations as well. We are in conversation with a lot of, you know, firms in India as well for some interesting collaborations. But collaborative culture is kind of slow and slowly progressing in India. So we are really hoping that things kind of become more favorable for collaborations in India. And yeah, at the same time, I would say, because since I'm only naming architects, so that's kind of wrong in a lot of sense, because when we talk of collaboration, I would really want to collaborate with scientists, with data scientists, with biologists. And in a very weird sense, I would tell you, I always had this dream that what if we can program the human body? You know, how can we understand that how our body reacts to an external stimuli, and what if we can program it in certain ways? So we're talking of, you know, more like, you know, humanoid version of technological intervention, which is kind of scary in its own way as well. You know, how can we make a hybrid of technology and human, I would say. So like a cyborg. So that's something that I was very interested in when in my early learning days, I would say. And I hope I can get back to that kind of a passion of working on a cyborgian project where we are infusing technology into human beings and working with biologists and scientists and technologists of various kinds. At the same time, I'm very interested in, you know, working on extraterrestrial projects. Again, that's like a far-fetched journey for, but I was very fortunate to meet a few very interesting people when I was in this conference in Ukraine recently. So I met Michael Bentley and Javier, who kind of handles these projects with NASA. So they are building 3D printed prototypes for Mars and Moon. So I would love to work on those kind of projects. And I really hope that Indian architects can actually get the opportunity to work on these kind of projects in some capacity, like making space stations or these kind of things. So that would be like a dream collaboration, I would say.
The last question in this section is, what are the emerging trends in the field of computational design?
What are the emerging trends? You're saying, okay, so emerging trends, I would say right now is artificial intelligence and machine learning. Those are the kind of two things which I really see taking shape, you know, in a lot of ways. I would say, apart from that, you know, virtual reality, mixed reality, augmented reality, gaming, these cross-country platforms are also something which are going to be quite interesting in its own ways. Yeah, so those are going to be quite interesting as well. There has been a lot of research done in robotics, but it's kind of suddenly stopped. But I think that will start to come back into limelight again, because let's say the pandemic has really, you know, changed the way we work and behave, you know, so sanitation, social distancing and all sorts of things will set up new norms where we will have to replace humans with robots. And when I say that, I do not say it in a very negative way, because I actually mean that the role of the humans will actually need to be adapt to be controlling these robots in a much more smarter way. So I think these are the kind of things which, and all of this is associated with computational design in some way or the other, or computing in some sense. So robotics, artificial intelligence, machine learning, I think these are the trends which I see like really taking shape and bringing in innovative tools in the computational design world.
I see. Now we will move to our next section, which is advice to students and young professionals. Sushant, what are some characteristics in timeless piece of architecture you have visited till date?
Timeless pieces of architecture I visited till date. Okay, so I have... So the one I can just relate to the term with that quote of Frank Gehry, actually, that, you know, architecture should yearn for timelessness and not should speak of its time, you know, when it was built. And the quote that is the building is popular with is Bilbao Museum, the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao. And I've seen that project, and I'm in love with that project, that building, in a lot of ways. And that's because it made the city more iconic, like, and more as a tourist attraction for Spain. And the Bilbao Airport, I would say, I can name quite a few actually. Like, I've been to these kind of projects. So Frank Gehry's Guggenheim Museum, the Guggenheim Museum of the Solomon Guggenheim Museum in New York, as well as one building, very simple Frank Lloyd Wright building and very impactful. Been into a lot of Zaha buildings, the Maxi Museum in Rome. That was a very interesting project. I've been into that. I've experienced, you know, some Jean Nouvel projects in Paris and then in London. Like, London is full of projects by a lot of fantastic architects, like Heatherwick's projects, Jean Nouvel and Tate Modern Museum, Tate Museum, Herzog de Muro's extension of Norman Foster's projects, City Hall. City Hall is an amazing project. Like, I was fortunately volunteering for the Open House London once. So I got to be in that building. Otherwise, you're not allowed in that building. And the Calatrava's projects, I love Calatrava's elegance. The project of New York, the Oculus, that was in construction when I went to New York. But I've seen as Bilbao Airport, which is a fantastic project. It is not a very popular project. Nobody speaks about that project much. But I think it's one of the best airports I've been to. It's a very small, a few terminals only. A single terminal, a few gates only, I think. But very, very well articulated project. You can see the Calatravian architecture coming into shape in that project. So I think my first journey outside of India was when I went for my master's. And I think right after that, I visited 20 countries since then, mostly for work. And I've been very fortunate to visit all the architectural projects and center all my visits and travels around these architectural buildings, actually. So I get to experience these projects. I would say these are the buildings that I've always loved.
And is there any common trend or pattern you observe in this different kinds of buildings?
I think one common trend for all of these projects and building is they actually reflect the work of the architect. And that's also because we as architects can relate to their work. You know, we know who Peter Eisenman was. We know who Zaha Hadid was. You know, we know who Norman Foster is, for example. So we can relate to their work and style, you know, for example. So I would say that's one thing common, that all of them have a sense of style. But principally, as an architect now, I don't believe in that sense of style, because every project has its own kind of meaning, you know. But at the same time, I know, you know, as creators, we kind of bring in some kind of style. You know, even if you look at you know, the projects that we have done at RatLab Studio, you, although the language would be different, you know, but you can somehow relate to it that these are our projects, you know, because of the kind of geometries. Of course, we have some of the projects are like completely fluidic and curvilinear. ZHS played a big impact on my life and my creativity, I would say. So that kind of comes out in the projects which are fluidic, and the projects which are faceted as something which, where we kind of try to bring in our whole level of complexity into place as well, and how we work on component aggregations at times, like what you see in my virtual background right now as well. That's one of our projects as well. But between all of these projects, I think two things common. One is a style that reflects. Second is the experience. That most of these projects have very well thought of the experience of the users, which is kind of more of a multi-sensorial experience, you know, that the architects have successfully able to transcend into the space. So I think that's one thing common. And I know that's something that doesn't come at times consciously or with deliberation, but it actually comes with a lot of experience and a lot of experience of failures as well, by failing to do on various projects.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And can you share something about developing right mindset for parametric design workflow?
Yeah. Okay. So talking of parametric design workflow, and since you kind of titled it, how to think parametrically as well. So I think that's something which is very, I'd love to talk about, because so computational thinking is actually a different field altogether. That is not same as computational design. And that's the problem that I see right now in the, you know, education circle right now, that a lot of people are actually focusing on software training and software teaching, and but nobody is talking much about the pedagogy of how you are teaching certain things. You know, that's something that we are consciously making a lot of efforts to inculcate in our various programs. Like, so how do you make someone think in a certain manner? You know, so they need to have some kind of understanding of computing, for example. So when you teach someone coding, you know, like you start from absolute simple and basics, you know, A plus B is equal to C, for example, then what is B plus C? You know, so, you know, going into logics, you need to train the mind to go with the logics. Similarly, when you talk of computational design, you have to train the mind to be able to look into logics, to be able to look into a software, and to be able to relate that to the application of that into a building. So that can only come with experience of working on that, those kind of projects. So it's a very to and fro approach. That's something that we try to bring in into our Smart Labs program, which is a 6-month program that I run, where we try to give in the design exercises in a manner where they start to think in a certain direction. You know, if you tell someone that design a table, I'm just giving you a random example right now, that if you tell someone design a chair, then you would start to design in a conventional approach. But then if you say design a chair, but before that, tell us how does a person sit and make a force diagram of that. And then you tell the person that if I give you this kind of tool and then I say design a chair, what will be your approach? And I would say, I will not give you this access to this another tool. Then what will your approach be? So your mind starts to adapt to certain workflows and at certain scales. So that is how computational thinking has to be done as well, that you need to train somebody's mind to be able to think computationally. So that goes a lot with exposing them to the right tools, technologies, and professional work as well. So that's where, you know, our role as, you know, as an academic, you know, innovator, I would say, comes into play, where we are able to bring in the expertise of the studio, what we're doing at RatLab Studio as well, and bring in that experience into teaching as well. So people can see the real applications of that. So how, there is no direct answer to that, the how do you make someone think computationally or parametrically, but I think there has to be a mix of theoretical understanding. So you need to expose someone to the right kind of theories, right kind of books, right kind of people who talk about certain things, right kind of talks. At the same time, you expose them to the right kind of softwares and tools, and not just one, but multiple of them, because otherwise they get restricted to learning only a particular software or a tool. So then they're not learning computational design or thinking. They're actually learning a software, and they can master that software, but they can never learn how to design or apply that software in a certain manner. So that's one thing that we try to do by mixing a lot of approach together. And so you create the kind of, you know, learning platform which allows you to train your mind in a certain way. So for example, when we start the Smart Labs program, we give everyone at least 3 to 4 months of reading, and only reading and focusing on theory. And we tell them very straightforward that don't focus on software, right? Don't focus on this particular thing. Don't focus on that. Only focusing on reading. So we'll give you 4 books. Just read those 4. Once you're done, then we'll give you the 5th and 6th book. We won't give you access of that without that. Then we try to create these very interesting assignments, like a cross check. Then you go through a certain kind of an assignment. Only once you're solved to a certain extent, then only you can move to the next stage. You know, so because people want access to everything at one go. You know, you don't want to do that. Not because you want to protect the content or data, but because you don't want the mind to wander around in the wrong zone. So that is very important. So we need to really understand the psychology of every single person. So, you know, even before we start the Smart Labs program, or, you know, any longer duration program which we are a part of, I like to do a one-on-one induction with the student and to understand the person's mind and bandwidth and capabilities and try to work around that. You know, somebody I see that who really has a passion towards something, I would not go to that person and tell that person that, you know, you might be good in coding or you might be good in interactive design, you know, for example. But I would just probably send the person a book or a video or a talk to inspire, you know, and then see how he reacts or she reacts, or how do they adapt to that kind of a thing. So we try to do that, but at the same time, it is very challenging because the current generation wants things quick, has lesser patience. So yeah, we try to kind of do a mind mapping to understand certain things. Yeah.
So I see it's not the end product. It's about like analyzing your process and like having exercise where is this the correct approach, and having that right framework, and it constantly evolves as you experiment.
Absolutely. Evolution is very important. So, you know, in the last 5 years of, teaching computation design, I can tell you that every program that we do, every workshop that we do, we have changed certain things. You know, we have evolved and adapted to certain things. You know, for recently we started doing online workshops, and I was very adamant that, you know, we should not do online workshop, because like we do online sessions in a Smart Labs program, but to facilitate the studio learning. That is how actually it started as a hybrid program. And now we are realizing that in the 4th batch of Smart Labs, we will have to reverse the whole way of learning, because it is going to be more of online and less of studio. Because what if people can't travel? What if the pandemic continues? How do you still facilitate a growth, you know, or an evolution? So, and now we have realized that people have started to adapt to the new normal of learning online. So that is a good thing about, you know, young people, I would say. They learn very quickly. They adapt to new technologies very quickly, even more quickly than they can imagine, to be honest. You know, so when you work with these set of students, you know, and you understand how they adapt to new things, you have to bring about a change in a similar manner in your way of teaching as well. So, you know, more of online learning, more of focusing on more tools, for example, exposing them to more number of things and technologies, and making them think in a particular manner so that they can learn to innovate, you know, and not just design certain things. At the same time, we've realized over the course of time that, you know, workshops are good for teaching technical aspects, but they can be very, very poisonous and dangerous, I would say, if I may use the word as negative as poisonous, because that happens because you can't apply those skills. You can't design using those tools if you're not in a right ecosystem. So providing that ecosystem or a community of people who are designing certain things is very, very important. And I totally can go back to what I mentioned in my initial conversation about being at Zaha's office, for example. You know, that provided me with such a conducive environment which allows you to think creatively. Providing that community of people who can work in a similar bandwidth is very important. And that is what we need to provide. And workshops, you know, 3 days you're teaching something and then you're done. You know, like then you lose. So building a community is very important. So that's what we try to do, because I think it's very important for people to know that you have to learn in a very open source, open learning environment and learn from each other and help each other. That's how we have learned as well, you know, in our times, I would say.
And what is the best piece of advice you have received till date?
Best piece of advice, somebody told me, don't leave architecture, don't do architecture. So I think that was the best piece of advice, which I did not follow, of course. No, I mean, I've actually had a lot of advice that you should do photography. I used to do a lot of photography. I still kind of do that when time allows. And I try to experiment with my photography skills and the kind of things that I shoot as well. Also, a lot of times people told me that, why are you doing architecture? You should be a photographer. You should pursue this full time. I'm yet to kind of, I've done a few exhibitions. I'm trying to get back to it now in some way or the other as well. But I would say that, like, that was on a lighter note as a best piece of advice, don't pursue and don't continue architecture. But the best piece of advice, there have been quite a few actually from my mentors, I would say. I'll tell you a few from my studio director, you know, like at MTech, you know, Mike Weinstock, who once told in a presentation that, you know, the best of the people, the most successful people are the ones, this was actually when we were preparing for a presentation, that the most successful people are the ones who know what to omit from your presentation and not just what to show in your presentation. Because then when you learn the art of being selective and showing only the things what you need to show, that's the best thing that you can learn with time. And that only comes with experience. You know, how can you make an impact in as less time as possible? So that's how I infer that thing, you know, like, and that's the rule of life I've learned. Because, you know, when you are discussing a project, you're in a project meeting, you are talking for 10 minutes. There are 10 more people talking for 10 minutes each. And that's a 1.5 hour has gone of discussion. So how do you make an impact of 1.5 hour in those 10 minutes? That can only happen when you learn to be selective in what you say. So learn to be selective and, you know, learn to, you know, kind of put the right things in the right place, you know. So those are the kind of things. Apart from that, I mean, there've been quite a few advice from my parents, I would say, to be grounded always, to be kind of, your head should be always high, but at the same time, you need to be grounded, whatever you're doing. Because at the end of the day, you are a human being who has to be a good human being at the end of the day. You know, like, so that's one thing that I never understood that, to be honest, for a very long period of time. And I know a lot of people say that, you know, that you need to be a good human being and you need to be compassionate. You need to be like nice to people around you. But then you realize that, okay, fine. These are very normal and cliched things which you hear around, you know. But to be honest, when you start to be in a very, very charged and collaborative and I would say competitive environment out there, that's when you realize, you know, that with the pressures of life, you need to be nice to people, you need to be humane, you need to be soft, you need to be grounded. So I think these are the best advice I have gotten and try to follow them. And I try to give that advice to a lot of people. Some people follow, some people don't. But that's what we can do, learn from each other and teach each other through our experiences and journeys, which are all unique in their own ways.
I see. What will be your piece of advice to students and young professionals who want to excel in the field of computational design?
Yeah, I think read a lot. That's what I would tell. And build up your skill sets slowly, one at a time. You know, don't rush into build up your skill sets, everything all together, because, you know, all of us have a certain, we all have a different way of thinking. We all have a different way of reacting to certain things. So I may be good in certain things, you may be good in something else. You know, what you are good at, I may be completely bad in that. You know, so, and that's something that you need to accept with time, that you can't do everything yourself. I can't be good in coding at the same time I can expect myself to be good in teaching, for example. You know, so, you need to realize these things. And for all the students out there, I would say that keep building your skill set, one skill at a time or a few skills at a time, and build onto a collective skill set of applying those things, you know. So that's very important. At the same time, I would say read a lot. You know, we are losing the touch of with reading, you know, so with the books, actually. We love collecting books. We love putting them and stacking them in our bookshelves because they look fantastic. But at the same time, we need to read them. And I'm myself guilty of not reading too much as I should be doing that, because the focus keeps changing all the time. But I really hope that I can make more time for reading and find the 25th hour in my daily schedule to do some reading, because understanding something from a theoretical point of view is very, very important. And to be honest, you know, that's one reason why my upcoming book is actually all about the theoretical aspect of technology and architecture. And from that perspective, and that's what I'm talking about in that book. And not focusing on any softwares or how to apply it in architecture, but talking from a very different perspective, which is, I think, is people need to be exposed to. So a lot of reading, build up your skill set once at a time, And that will also make you realize one thing, that you need to collaborate with others. And that is a skill set that you need to inculcate as a designer, always.
So is there any question you never get asked but would like to answer?
That's a tough one. There have been quite a few. I mean, suddenly you ask me, like, I can't think of any. But if I have to think of something, yeah, I mean, I wish I was asked how hard it is to do all of this. We never ask that usually. You know? Like, to be honest, although you ask that in the first set of the interview, that what is your day look like? But nobody talks about these kind of aspects. Like, how do you deal with success or failure? You know, these are the kind of things that people need to talk about. Or how do you feel under so much of pressure because being involved in so many things, you know? So I wish I was asked that. And so since we self-created this question out of the necessity of it, I'd like to answer that very broadly as well, that it is very difficult at times, and it is very stressful at times as well, because I would say it's not everybody's journey. And I mean, the problem is that I still feel that we need to do so much of more. And there is this hunger of doing more and more things in less amount of time, which is really driving us crazy at times. At the same time, we're trying to manage ourselves well. But I really don't know how the day starts and day ends, and the next day starts looking at new challenges and opportunities. But I think it's very exciting to be living a life pretty much on a sword's edge, or living or walking on a tight rope, rather, where you can kind of fall here or there at any point, and you are risking so many things. Like I told you about the platform, we are pretty much risking, after reaching the peak in these 5 years, we are risking everything and killing all of that and putting that for free into this platform for the next few years. So you just need to be a part of the community, which is just attracting a very small price to pay. But it is really helping us to kind of evolve into a different level altogether. So these are the kind of risks that we're talking of, you know, like, one day we are a collaborative practice. One day we realize that how difficult it is to collaborate with architects across India. And suddenly we take a decision that, okay, today we're going to stop doing that. You know, today we're just going to start, you know, working on competitions, for example, or doing the projects that we are being offered otherwise without any collaboration, because people need to see the output. And when you work in collaborations, you know, you get stopped in certain ways as well. So those are the kind of challenges that have happened, which create a lot of mental pressure as well. So to answer that self-developed question, I would say it is damn hard. And I really hope that I continue to do that with the same kind of passion every single day, because I don't want to stop on this, you know, because I hope that someday I can look back and say that all of the efforts that I was doing that time were actually the foundation to what we are doing today. So I hope that day comes, because today I am very proud to say that whatever I did in the last 10 years or so, I would say, all of that was the foundation to what we're doing right now. Without that, without those sleepless nights, without those efforts that we did, without those multiple projects that we did, without getting paid for, without those volunteering that we did for so many aspects, without putting our integrity in question as well, I would say that all of that paid off in different ways now. So I hope that journey in the graph continues in that sense, with its falls and drops that would keep happening. But I hope we keep getting those peaks as well.
That's quite. How can our listeners follow you and your work?
Right. So to follow us, of course, right now we invite everyone to be on this platform. Of course, we are opening it up only to RatLab Education community, which is actually the community of people who have been a part of RatLab Education workshops or programs or conferences of various kinds. We're just opening up to them to start with, and only if you are in India, actually. So because this platform is actually made with one sole motive, to make design education in this particular segment accessible and affordable to all in India. So we want to maintain that thing for now before making it global. And we want to build this community first. So I would say reaching out is, of course, through this platform, one thing. But apart from that, we are very active on Instagram right now. I don't know if it probably shift to new platforms. But yeah, you can go to our website, rat-lab.org, or we are coming up with possibly a new website for education as well, so which we're trying. And then this one is edulab.com. So that's something that is one thing. And then Instagram is ratlabarch, ratlab_edu. That's where we are most responsive. But for any kind of advice or an actual conversation, we always prefer emails. So we are kind of old school in that sense. Even though we are very responsive on Instagram, I would say, if the DM reaches us. But we still prefer always a formal environment of discussion on, you know, through emails. So yeah, people can reach out to us. They can always write to info@ratlab.org, which pretty much gets filtered and channeled into different segments. And they reach out to me in different ways. We have different verticals and different departments now handled by different people. So I think that's quite exciting now that we are able to channelize different kind of queries in different directions. But yeah, the best place is Instagram to reach out to us.
Well, now we will move to our final section of the interview, in which Sushant will talk about self-directed learning, how to find mentors, and importance of postgrad for architecture. And this interview part will be exclusively published on EduLab India portal. So yeah,
right.
Thanks a lot, Sushant, for sharing your journey, advice, and your professional work.
And thank you. It was a fantastic conversation, and I know we can keep going and talking about various things and facets, but I think this is very exciting to talk about some very interesting aspects. And I think the whole point of view of talking about these things is that hopefully it helps out someone out there. Hopefully it can make an impact to someone, and hopefully it can positively affect someone, because, you know, to be honest, I speak from my heart, I would say, and I'm very candid about certain things, and I'm very honest about whenever I'm doing these kind of talks. Something that we can't do always when we are doing workshops and all sorts of things, because we are in a certain kind of an environment and setting. But here we can speak our heart out on these kind of sessions, and hopefully it helps out. You know, we try to talk about things which can help out young people out there, which is what I'm really focused on, because those are the future and the flag bearers of innovation of our country as well in future. So thank you very much, Mayur, for having me a part of this discussion. And I look forward to many more interactions in future. And just before we begin. So, I mean, firstly, I would like to thank you, so we can move to the next section of the interview, because I know this is going to be like a 2-part video. So firstly, thank you for conducting this session and for inviting me for this interview. And I hope the knowledge that we shared, you know, so far in this discussion is useful to students out there or to professionals out there.